All right, everyone, we're going to get started just a minute early. Today's grand rounds, we have three presenters. The first presenter is Sean Collon. He's a PGY4. If I was to give a spirit animal to Sean Collon, it would be the pangolin, which is found in Africa and Asia. It's a highly intelligent, sometimes self-isolating creature that likes to explore and ask a lot of questions. Sean Collins' presentation is entitled Providing Eye Care for Utah's Uninsured and Underinsured.
Thank you, Tyler. I'm curious what questions the pangolin asks. Is this food? Also, is that the one with the armor on it? Does it have a little bit of armor? That's very nice. I like that. So I'm going to be talking about providing eye care for Utah's underinsured and uninsured patients, specifically at the Moran Eye Center. I did a lot of talking with people for this presentation. I talked with attendings, I talked with fellows, talked with front desk staff, with PFAs, with people on the fifth floor, and it's an incredibly complicated topic. There's a lot of murkiness in it. This presentation is my attempt to synthesize everything I've learned, and there will undoubtedly be inaccuracies and some areas of incompleteness, but I hope that providers will come away with a better idea of ideally what track a patient should be taking if they're self-pay and how they can sort of minimize the impact on their own clinic flow and provide these patients with the best care. Really briefly, I'm going to talk about the Utah Teleophthalmology Program, which is something that we started a few years ago. It started small with People's Health Clinic in Park City. It has pretty rapidly grown to include Moab Free Clinic, the Association for Utah Community Health, which is an umbrella organization comprising all the federally qualified health centers in the state. So we're working with Community Health Centers, Inc. at 7 centers in the Salt Lake area, Family Health Care with 2 centers in Southwest Utah, Mountainlands Family Health Center with 4 centers in Provo, 1 in Eastern Utah, and Enterprise Valley Medical Clinic in Southwest Utah for a total of 15 clinics. We've been working with one clinic in sort of a pilot project for the past year. And as you can see, the orange line there is their diabetic retinopathy screening rate. So they've gone from under 30% to over almost 70% over the past year. It's a fairly large clinic, but it is ultimately only one of the 15 that we're going to be working with in the next couple of months. So we're getting a lot more patients identified that need eye care, and many of them don't have insurance. As we expand this, this is not terribly pertinent, but we're going to be working with iNook, which is one of the two FDA-approved AI algorithms in the US. We're using this AI in the background program because their fully autonomous program, iArt, is not approved for the camera that the clinics have chosen to work with. One thing that is exciting, just learned about this yesterday, is that their AMD and glaucoma algorithms just got approved for fully autonomous use in Europe. They're not approved in the US, but they will be implemented with the AI in the background. So our clinics will be some of the first in the US to have access to that technology. All of our clinics are using this camera. They've all independently come to the conclusion that this is the best one. And I can talk more about any of the sort of specifics of this program with people if they're interested. But the end result is that we're seeing a lot of pathology. This population, you know, we're screening lots of uninsured patients, and the rate of pathology, the incidence of pathology is just very high. Lots of diabetic retinopathy, lots of glaucoma, other issues. And so we need providers in the state who are gonna provide care for these patients. As a bit of reassurance to the people at the Moran, we are not relying on the Moran to provide all of this care. And in fact, we're actively trying to offload a lot of this burden to the community. So we've set up this, Outreach has set up this website, the Utah Teleophthalmology Program, which should be going live in the near future. It will be a resource for clinics to find providers, who optometrists and ophthalmologists, who have specifically signed up to provide eye care for uninsured patients at an affordable cost. We gave this presentation at the Utah Ophthalmology Society, and we had an incredible response from the people there. So many people there signed up on the spot to provide care specifically for uninsured patients or to be a resource for that. For providers at the Moran, there's no real need to sign up. Just being at the Moran, you will be seeing some of these patients. But if you would prefer not to see any uninsured patients, you can reach out to Erica and she can help to facilitate that. Erica Ruiz, that is, she's right here. She's going to be talking in a second from outreach. Regardless, though, even as we try to offload patients into the community, there will still be self-pay patients coming to Moran. Of course, there always have been, but a lot of providers have noticed that there are more, at least some of which is due to this program. And when patients come here, they have a few options. They can pay their bill up front. They can use a payment plan, sign up for a payment plan. They can apply for financial assistance. And if all that fails, they can be set up with outreach. And we'll talk about all these a little bit more. Ideally, when a patient comes to the Moran, they end their self-pay. They'll go through sort of this process here. So they'll check in at the front desk. The front desk staff will check, recheck, confirm that the patient is indeed self-pay uninsured. If they are, before they're even roomed, they should meet with a PFA. They should be given a estimate of the cost of their visit, and they should be given a financial assistance application. They can't complete that until they actually have the bill from the visit, but they can be sort of educated about that process. After they've got all that, they have the information they need to move forward with the appointment with the provider if they'd like, which most patients will. And then they receive their bill, and after that, it's sort of incumbent on them to figure out how they're going to pay it. Absolutely. And we'll go into each one of these quite a bit more. There is one sort of consideration here. You know, according to the No Surprises Act, which was effective in January of 2022, they should be getting a good faith estimate before they even come to the Moran. That good faith estimate should provide the expected cost of their visit. There are tons of logistical difficulties in actually doing this. I'm not sure the extent to which it happens. But this is the actual sort of text from the No Surprises Act. Regardless, whether they get it before they come or as soon as they arrive, they get this estimate. This is what it looks like. This is an actual scanned, de-identified copy. This is basically the charges that a patient would get for fundus photos and an OCT. Comes out to about $300, which in the grand scheme of things is not that much. And you can see that there are facility charges and then provider charges here on this bill. They do get a 30% contribution to care from the University of Utah on the base charge. So, you know, once they have met with the PFAs, talked about those things, gotten the financial assistance application, been explained that they will get a bill, they proceed to their appointment. And I just want to give some examples. A lot of people will already know these numbers, but some may not have. What patients might see in their bill. So intravitreal injections will be one of the most common things that these patients need. There are several options: Avastin, Eylea, Vabysmo, Lucentis. Avastin is of course generally affordable, so it's an okay option in that regard. The other drugs we often have samples of, which can be a good option for a patient who needs treatment on their first visit. But then in particular, Eylea and Vabysmo have very good free drug programs that patients can enroll in. My understanding is that they're actually quite a bit easier than the financial assistance program, especially the Genentech program for Vabysmo right now. But even if they get these drugs covered, the $2,000, $3,000 for the cost of the drug is covered, they're still paying, you know, roughly $700 just for the cost of the procedure. You know, the facility fee is $579.20. They get that 30% contribution to care, so it's $405.44. But the interesting thing here is that for an insured patient, the insurance company will get the same bill, $579.20, but then only pay $346. So patients paying out of pocket are actually paying about $60 more than the insurance companies, just in this example here. A few more procedure costs here. The main point is just that these numbers are very large, even for something like a YAG capsulotomy patient's going to be a couple thousand dollars out of pocket. The website at the bottom has examples of some of the procedures that patients might have and the costs of those procedures, but it's not very comprehensive. The only ophthalmologic procedure that I could find was for the YAG capsulotomy, but that website's available to everyone. It can be accessed by the public. The financial assistance program here, we have patients should be getting a copy of this when they come in before their visit, when they meet with the PFAs. It's a fairly involved application process. They need to complete the application, explain their financial status, provide bank statements, income tax returns, pay stubs, and then they need to complete this whole application here, where they're asked to provide their household size, income, assets, medical debts, other debts. And it's really important to know that these patients can get help with this by calling the number on the first page of the application. My understanding is that if they call that number, someone will walk them through this application step by step. You know, it can be very intimidating. So it's really important that patients know that they do have that support system as they're going through the process. And after they do, they potentially get a really awesome coverage, up to 100% of the cost of their care covered. It may only be approved for 6 months. That's what the technical literature says on the website, the policy. I'm not sure how much that's enforced or if it's easier to reapply, but that is the policy. Now, I'd actually meant to turn this over to Cindy Hart, who's one of our lead PFAs at Mid Valley a few slides ago, but I think now would be a good time, just if Cindy's with us on the call, just to talk about what PFAs can and should be doing with patients who are self-pay when they come to Moran for the first time. Cindy here. You should be able to unmute yourself. She's not. Okay. Well, that's fine. But basically what I was hoping and what I understand she would say is that the PFAs here can meet with patients, again, before the visit, before the patient's roomed, give them that estimate of what the procedure or visit is going to cost, talk to them about the financial assistance application, and, you know, give them sort of the reassurance that they'll need when they get their bill. The benefit of having them meet with them before their visit is that it doesn't take up an exam room for the provider, minimally disrupts clinic flow, and hopefully that'll make things smoother for our providers who are seeing the patients. Yes. Yeah, so they'll be identified as self-pay when they come in, when the appointment is made. Right, they call, they ask, what insurance do you have? I don't have any, so on and so forth, right? They're identified. But then when they come, the front desk staff will talk with them, double check in their chart that they are in fact self-pay and do everything they can to make sure that they are not insured in some way that the patient might not be aware of. That's kind of the process they go through, the vetting process. This part, I really don't want to touch on too much at all. The question often comes up, sort of, what do you have to bill for? What don't you have to bill for? Do you have to order imaging? I can say definitively that it is illegal to provide a service for free if the patient, if the provider knows or should know that it will induce some sort of payment from a government health plan. That's for sure. In terms of whether or not it's, you know, illegal to provide a service for free if the patient is uninsured, that's something that I haven't been able to get a very clear answer on, although it is clear that it may be in violation of University of Utah compliance rules. The other thing that's definitely clear is that you can minimize the testing that you order. Order only what's necessary and just be aware of the patients coming in who are self-pay and you know, don't get tests that aren't absolutely necessary. For outreach is obviously an incredible resource for all of our patients. We get tons of operation site day patients getting cataract and pterygium surgery. We have our Mid-Valley retina clinics on Saturdays where patients incur no bills, no charges when they go, but it is a limited resource. And so it's very important that patients go through the proper channels, that they apply for the financial assistance programs, the drug programs before they go to outreach, before they're referred to outreach. Erica Ruiz from Outreach really runs effectively all of this. And so I was just gonna have her speak up right now and just talk about sort of the most important things that providers should know about when to refer a patient to outreach and how. Yeah, go ahead. We have a microphone. I'll bring you a microphone to your seat.
Hi, so typically with our retina clinic, we are able to do injections, imaging, and lasers. And we want to save those spots for patients that have gone through all this process and completely cannot qualify for any type of assistance. So as soon as you get a retina patient and it's self-pay, don't send it straight to outreach. Have them go through a PFA and go through all that process first. That'll actually help them in the long run, because if they do qualify for financial assistance, they're able to get assistance throughout the whole hospital, not just for outreach, or sorry, retina. And then for our operation site day, we refer patients that need cataract surgery that have gone through the whole process, the vetting process. And we'll get them into our continuity clinic to see one of our chief residents. Once they see the chief residents and they determine that they need surgery, we'll get them in with our surgeons who have agreed to waive their fees. And they'll get them into their regular OR schedule during the week, Monday through Friday. We still have to pay for the facility fee outreach does, but at least the doctors are waiving their fee for to do that. So that's pretty amazing. We also have our once a year CAT operation site day event that's held on a Saturday. And we typically do about 18 surgeries on that day. The capacity for the year for surgeries is up to 174 surgeries. That's 18 surgeries a month that our doctors are doing during their regular working hours or our days. And then our Saturday event is 18 patients. So we've been able to do a lot of surgery cases since we started doing the adding patients to our regular OR. So it's pretty amazing what the surgeons are doing. The chief residents and our PFAs are working to get those patients taken care of.
Thank you so much. And just to be clear, I think sort of the main points then are just to, before referring a patient to outreach, make sure they've gone through the whole process, meet with the PFA, apply for the financial assistance. And then they can just contact you directly with that patient's information once they have. Is that correct? Perfect. All right. And you touched on this there, but continuity clinics are a good place to send these patients, especially for cataract evaluations. I bundled in call and consults here because it's the same sort of billing considerations apply. There are various restrictions or qualifications that each of the insurers need in order to be able to bill. But again, for uninsured patients, we're really able to minimize their charges. And just for residents to know, when a patient comes into your continuity clinic and they're uninsured, if they've come through an established channel, like People's Health Clinic, 4th Street Clinic, or Malahi Clinic, they should be well vetted. If they're uninsured, that means they're uninsurable. And those patients will generally be covered by outreach if needed. Other uninsured patients, though, who are not coming through one of those channels, need to still meet with a PFA before their appointment with you. So that's important to know. In summary here, before the visit, patients may or may not get a good faith estimate of what their visit cost will be. If they don't get it beforehand, they should get that first thing before they are roomed when they meet with the PFA. They should also be provided with a financial assistance application, informed that they will receive a bill and that they can't complete that application until they receive a bill. And then we'll proceed with their visit, where it's sort of incumbent on the provider to minimize charges as possible. After the visit, they have to apply for the financial assistance program and the drug program. Remember that they can call that number on the front of the financial assistance application to be walked through the whole process, and then refer to outreach only if they're denied the other assistance. As far as the provider role here, a lot of this still comes down to individual initiative and motivation here at the Moran. So every member of the team is vital in providing this care, from the front desk staff to the PFAs to the technicians. If they can understand the process and know the resources that are available to the patient in order to reassure them, give them the information they need, that goes a long ways. And so just building that culture within your clinics is a super important step. You can minimize charges by ordering only what's necessary. And then also you can delay treatment if that's appropriate, non-central DME or moderate glaucoma. You can see that patient, bill them the absolute minimum possible, and then see them back in a month or two after they've had time to complete the financial assistance application, after they've had the 2 or 3 weeks for that to get processed, and then give them the treatment they need, you know, with the security that it will be covered by that program. It's just extremely important to encourage them to complete that application, to call the number, to get the help they need, and then just in general to understand the patient experience, be able to reassure them in the various aspects of the appointment and of their healthcare that they are understandably concerned about. In the future, you know, this is an imperfect system, and none of these solutions are fantastic. Some ideas that are in the works are having a full-time optometrist at the South Main Clinic, which is actually a school of medicine clinic, not a University of Utah clinic, and so has some flexibility in its ability to bill and charge patients. And the optometrist would function to triage patients without giving them much billing and get them set up with the financial assistance program. And another idea that would really be beneficial is having a full-time social worker here at the Moran with the specific role of interacting with these uninsured self-pay patients and helping them with the financial assistance application, helping them with surgical scheduling, but also just providing education, providing help with transportation, with medications. And actually, Dan Clegg commented here that the University of Utah Pharmacy Services has a program that can also help patients afford their outpatient prescriptions. It's called the Medication Support Service, and he has info in the pharmacy if anyone wants that. These are just a few special considerations. I'll leave people to read these on their own. We've only got a couple minutes left, so I'll turn it over to any comments, questions. Catherine.
Sean, thanks so much for looking into all these, you know, pathways and channels. I think a lot of times it's been unclear in the past, not necessarily because I think mostly just because people have not done a deep dive as you. And I know a lot of these processes have been in place a lot with our PFAs, which we really appreciate. One clarification is with those outreach patients that come to Chief Clinic and Continuity Clinic from, you know, 4th Street Clinic, we've always been told not like to bill a 99, basically no charges. Are we supposed to be billing for the visit and then outreach reimburses those charges? That's a technical question. Just closing encounters wise, I feel like hasn't really been made clear to us before.
Yeah, and I don't know the answer to that question, Dr. Patty.
Yeah, so let me get a real accurate answer.
Okay. Let's
distribute that out.
Okay.
99 is actually something that was a bit historical.
Okay.
So we'll get a better answer back, and then. Just a couple of comments, unless you had another question.
Yeah.
Sean, thank you. This like working within this for years, it's been still less clear than it was just now with you doing that. This is something that will live on, and that as faculty ask questions, they're going to be referred to this on Moran Core for many years. So thank you. This was a heavy lift. A couple of things that I think are important. You know, as surgeons, we waive our fees for these operation site day, and sometimes you might feel like, well, what's the institution doing on their end? You know, anytime you allow a free, quote unquote, surgery to go into a scheduled spot, you're losing revenue. And that's why across the country, programs do not do this in the regular OR block, is because of the opportunity costs and the loss of revenue. So I think that's just an institutional commitment that is worth noting. And then I do want to give a shout out to Tyler Etheridge, who is going to be looking at, you know, if we knew how much things were at the time that they were being ordered, how is that going to modify behavior in a way that could really affect costs and utilization of your maintenance? So, Tyler, I don't know if you wanted to say anything, but I'm really excited for that. Oh, there you are. Okay.
All right. Okay.
If someone is denied the assistance, are they then, what are they told then? Are they told to then go through outreach or talk to the provider? And I can see that maybe they might just go away if they aren't, don't have a...
Absolutely. That is a tricky situation. If they're denied financial assistance, then that would be the time to send them to outreach. What they're told, I would imagine they're just told that they've been denied financial assistance. And so to that end, you know, I think it would be important to tell the patient at their visit what to do if they're denied financial assistance. Certainly they can contact the provider, and then the provider can reach out to Erica to establish them in whatever outreach channel they need to be in. Nam?
Thank you for your talk, Sean. This question might not just be for you, but for anyone in the room. Sometimes I'm looking at medications that we send out, not just for like underserved populations, but just in general. And I think it'd be really fascinating or appreciative if we had kind of an estimate on what it would cost a patient. So, you know, the various derivatives of a certain medication or artificial tears, for instance, should I recommend one brand or another? This cost, how significant of a factor is that play in? And I don't know if anyone has like a list or kind of a database that they use when they send things out. I think that'd be really great to share.
On call, I found myself referring to GoodRx a lot to look at the different drug prices. Otherwise, it's a little bit variable with different insurances. But in terms of kind of a overall estimate, if they're not insured, being out of pocket, that was kind of my question.
Thanks, everyone. That's time. And if you do have any feedback on the process, you know, Dr. Kyle would have explicitly said that he would be happy to hear that. If your PFAs are uncertain about how to manage these things, they can be referred to Cindy Hart, who has a ton of experience navigating these situations, for sort of continuing education on the process. And then I personally would be very happy to get any feedback about patients who are coming from this screening program. If you're encountering any issues with them or you know, their insurance status or whatever, when they're coming into your clinic, it'd be really helpful to hear. Thanks.
And just to address two comments that were posted online, Dr. Fleckenstein basically said, thank you for all the information that you provided, Sean. And then I believe Dan Clegg had mentioned University of Utah Pharmacy Services has a program to help qualified patients afford outpatient prescriptions. This is called Medication Support Service. And there's information in the pharmacy or at the pharmacy if you are all interested. So our next presenter, Abigail Jebaraj, she's also a chief ophthalmology resident. If I was to choose, actually, I asked her what her spirit animal would be, and she chose the meerkat because she's small. However, little did she know, the meerkat is one of the strongest animals. In fact, it is impermeable to snake venom and does not drink water. It gets all of its water and nutrients from what it eats. Abigail Jebaraj will be presenting a team effort, management of granulomatosis with polyangiitis.
Thanks, Tyler. The no water thing sounds like me on a VA OR day, so not fit. Let's see. All right, good morning, everyone. I'll be presenting a case of a patient that I saw with granulomatosis with polyangiitis. We have a 68-year-old Hispanic male who presented to triage clinic initially, who had a history of 2 months of significant bilateral ocular pain, photophobia, significant redness, and blurry vision that was intermittent. His testing was overall normal, vision of 20/30, 20/20 uncorrected, normal intraocular pressures, normal pupillary exam, normal visual field testing, full motility, and color plate testing was full bilaterally. However, when we turn to his slit lamp exam, a lot of red here you see. So of note, he had no proptosis. He did have bilateral injection with some scleral show, as well as his injection did not blanch completely with phenylephrine, as well as keratitis. He had a peripheral corneal haziness without staining and trace pigmented cells post-dilation in the anterior chamber on the left side. Mild cataract, no vitritis, no retinal findings. So the question was where to go next with this patient who looked like this on slit lamp exam. As you can see, hopefully on the screen, I know it can be difficult to see up there. This is a slit lamp photo of the left eye. Supranasally, there's a bluish tint there, which is kind of the uveal show of scleral thinning, as well as those deeply injected vessels. And along the limbus there, you can see some of those immune deposits or inflammatory reaction there. Let me see if I can pick that. There we go, right there, some of those spots. Also important was his review of systems. Over the preceding year, he also had a dry cough, sinusitis, and an unintentional weight loss of 15 pounds. In summary, this is a patient with bilateral scleritis and keratitis with scleral thinning in the setting of 1 year of dry cough, sinusitis, and that unintentional weight loss. The differential diagnosis is broad and really depends upon the patient's symptoms, whether or not the patient is presenting more with pulmonary symptoms or sinusitis. In this case, I looked more at kind of the ocular findings. You look at other vasculitides, you look at other autoimmune diseases, things that can cause orbital inflammation, scleritis. You can't forget infection causes, as well as malignancies that can present like this. Next, we moved on to the lab workup, getting different lab testing for the C-INCA titer was elevated, and I have the reference value there. As you can see, it was quite elevated, and that reflexes to the ELISA test for anti-PR3, which was also elevated. Of note, his CMP and urinalysis were normal, and then things that were tested that were not that were normal or negative were the listed here things here, which can also present with similar findings, particularly other great masqueraders such as syphilis and tuberculosis. We also got a CRP and ESR, which were elevated in the setting of systemic inflammation. There was a question in the beginning, given some of his ocular symptoms and some headaches, that we were thinking about GCA. However, given the whole clinical picture, there was in the end a low clinical suspicion for this. The next steps of things that we ordered were, because of this deep ocular pain that he reported and a question of whether or not there were orbital findings, although he had no proptosis, we did obtain an MRI orbits with and without contrast, as well as a CT chest given his elevated C-INCA and anti-PR3, and referrals to rheumatology and the pulmonary departments were made. He was started on prednisolone eye drops 4 times daily in both eyes, as well as naproxen orally 2x a day. This is his MRI orbit with and without contrast. Here, there was no orbital inflammation, but you did see at the insertion point of the optic nerve bilaterally. And in this cut, the left eye is better shown than the right, but there were enhancement on T1 post correlating with STIRB right signal intensity, which was consistent with scleritis of both eyes. Moving on to a CT scan chest, this was kind of the thing that stood out most to me in his history and reviewing his case was he did have this hilar lymphadenopathy more prominent on the right side. You can see here, marked here, 12.6 millimeters and 13.8 millimeters here, as well as these scattered bilateral pulmonary nodules. And this is just the report for that. So the hilar adenopathy wasn't very specific, and it's not for this disease. So the question of a neoplastic process kind of guided our next step, which we would have done anyway given this diagnosis, would be a biopsy. So CT-guided fineal aspiration biopsy was performed at the right lower lobe, and it showed characteristic necrotizing granular inflammation with multinucleated giant cells and confirmed our suspected diagnosis of GPA. This is just a representative image of the pathology that you can get with this disease, the necrotizing granulomatous inflammation, fibrosis, these multinucleated giant cells that you can see here, and a lot of inflammatory cells collecting essentially in these areas of granulomas. So as I mentioned, we referred this patient to rheumatology. It was determined that his disease is pulmonary and ocular involving with renal sparing. He also reported polyneuropathy, which can be seen in this disease. So that was an important question that is kind of a gray area for this patient, but something that is still possible. Given the severity of his lung and ocular involvement, there was a concern for a high risk of relapse, which does happen in GPA anyways, and something to be very aware of in these patients. So he follows with rheumatology quite closely and is on prednisone. At the time, he was started on a 1 mg/kg dosing with a taper down over time and rituximab infusions every 6 months. So a GPA is a multi-system autoimmune disease. And as I mentioned, it's a classically necrotizing granulomatous vasculitis that involves small to medium arteries and veins. And that's important as it kind of differentiates it from different vasculitides. It classically involves the upper and lower respiratory tract causing granulomas. Classically, if you go back to your step setting, you can see a saddle nose deformity when the septum cartilage collapses with this disease. And you can also have focal segmental glomerulonephritis. This disease is typically seen in middle-aged patients. It has a predisposition more for Caucasian individuals, but can really happen in anyone. And the ocular and orbital involvement tends to be 15% at time of presentation, up to 50% in the course of the disease. Orbital inflammation is the most common as it's thought to be a contiguous inflammation from the sinuses and spread to the orbital tissue. Secondarily, other more common presentations are, like in our patient, episcleritis, scleritis, keratitis. Less frequently, but still possible, are uveitis, optic neuropathy, retinal pathology, and contiguous with the orbital inflammation is NLDO. So what's ANCA, as we all kind of think back to what we learned in medical school? Antibodies directed against the cytoplasmic xerophilic granules of neutrophils and monocytes. This is specific for vasculitis, so ANCA is, such as GPA, microscopic polyangiitis, eosinophilic granulomatitis with polyangiitis, which is formerly known as Türk-Strauss syndrome. See ANCA is present in 95. It's pretty specific for GPA as well as PR3 ANCA to evaluate these things. PR3 ANCA is typically tested by ELISA. So the treatment really depends upon disease severity. It's kind of a stepwise therapy up. You start with steroids and then you move on to methotrexate, cyclophosphamide, or rituximab. The really severe diseases you'll treat with IVIG or plasma exchange. Typically it's a combination of steroids and an immunomodulatory therapy. Before treatment was available, before immunomodulatory treatment was used, there was almost a 90% mortality in the first 5 years. So it was significantly dangerous to these patients. Rituximab of interest, which was used in our case, is typically more tolerated than methotrexate or cyclophosphamide. It's effective at treating ocular manifestations and pretty effective at preventing relapses, which I mentioned does happen quite a lot with this disease. Renal sparing was an interesting point because I thought that if it wasn't involving the kidneys, then the patient would have a better outcome in general, but that's not necessarily true. It's kind of a misnomer to categorize it that way. So renal involvement parallels disease severity, but the lack of renal disease does not imply decreased morbidity. That's something really important to note as they can have upper respiratory, they can have CNS involvement as well. So that's really important to keep in mind that that doesn't mean that you kind of let your guard down at all with these patients. As such, monitoring kidney function is essential because in a prior big study done with 158 patients, it's present in 18% of patients at presentation, but over the course of 2 years, up to 77 to 85% of patients do develop renal involvement. So that's really important to watch them closely. Our patient's clinical course, the treatment has been upheld well in him with topical and systemic steroids, as well as rituximab infusions. He's had no progression of inflammatory ocular disease over the course of the last 2 years that we've been watching here in clinic, as well as no renal involvement that's popped up. Of note, he did develop tracheal stenosis, which is found with GPA and is being managed by ENT. He has an upcoming cataract surgery of the right and left eye with Dr. La Rochelle with a perioperative course planned of topical pred, ketorolac, and oral pred. This was a team effort, kind of alluding to my title here. There really is something for everyone when it comes to GPA. It's kind of a masquerader, just like a lot of these inflammatory or infectious diseases that we see. It's important to know that involvement of other specialties is important. In this patient, there was neurology, rheumatology, pulmonology, ENT, and so many other specialties that were involved in the care of this patient. So in terms of the Moran side of things, Dr. La Rochelle with uveitis is kind of quarterbacking his care. So for the PGY2 for me 2 years ago, lessons learned from this is it's kind of hard on call when you're looking at these patients and trying to figure out what's going on, but take a breath, step back, go through your review of systems, because that can really elucidate, as it did in this patient, the underlying cause of their pathology. Examine the patient at the slit lamp in different directions of gaze. In this patient, if you didn't lift the lid and look superiorly, you might have missed that scleral thinning. So that's really important, as it's not readily available in primary gaze at the slit lamp. Beware of masquerading or unclear clinical pictures. That's where the whole clinical picture kind of comes into play. So having a broad differential diagnosis and really thinking through things is super important in these patients. And finally, collaboration is key. The management of patients with GPA is not possible without our rheumatology colleagues. Here are my sources. Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Abigail, for that wonderful presentation. Our next presenter, let me actually double check to make sure we don't have any comments. Our next presenter is David Botros, a PGY1 with neurosurgery. I did a quick Google search of him and found that he is from Egypt and moved to Indiana when he was about 9. And so my spirit animal for him is the steppe eagle, which is the national bird of Egypt and travels extensive distances, both individually and as a pack. His presentation is on the neuro-ophthalmic manifestations of acute hydrocephalus. And I need to unmute him. You should be able to unmute yourself.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
We'll get your presentation pulled up.
All right. Is it okay if I share my screen?
Go for it.
Perfect. Okay. So first off, thank you so much for that introduction. I did not expect that and actually didn't know that about the Egypt's spirit animal. So thank you very much. So I'll be presenting on the neuro-ophthalmic manifestations of obstructive hydrocephalus, knowing that there are sort of a lot of different entities within hydrocephalus, but trying to focus and kind of make it a relatively streamlined presentation. So just a very quick kind of history of the ventricular system, kind of started as early as Aristotle. And he was kind of the first to describe these cavities that were located in each hemisphere, as he saw in many kind of the animals in the cadaveric dissections, that they tended to have these holes in their brain that contained some fluid. Again, these were limited by fixation ability and things like that. So it was sort of difficult to elucidate further. In the humans, at least in the 1300s, they were able to sort of get to this in the picture here, this like tricameral system or three cavity system that they saw, thought that this facilitated the regulation of the flow of the pneuma psychicon or the spiritus animalis and or the psyche, and allowing kind of the transition of memory, all of which were ultimately changed over time. As we got to Leonardo da Vinci, and they had wax models, they would fill these the ventricles with wax and were able to preserve them. And so they had these semi accurate representations of what the ventricles look like in vivo, so to speak. And then that slowly developed into our understanding today of what these ventricles look like, which sort of the general outflow starts in the lateral ventricles, moves into the interventricular foramen or the foramen of Monroe, into the third ventricle, through the cerebral aqueduct, into the fourth ventricle, ultimately ending up through sort of the foramen of Magendie and Lushka and into the arachnoid granulations is at least the traditional thought. There's more kind of emerging evidence that there are lymphatic vessels that are involved in the resorption of CSF as well. And so there's many points that you can kind of disrupt the ventricular system and cause obstructive hydrocephalus. So we'll start at the most kind of proximal point, which would be the foramen of Monroe. So this is a case of a colloid cyst. And generally, these are typically thought to be fairly benign, but if they get to one of the, at least the risk factors, if they get to above 7 millimeters, they can kind of cause obstructive symptoms. And about a third of patients may actually present, between 3 and 35% will present with acute hydrocephalus and rapid deterioration as a result. So generally, these are left alone until they get to become this size. And so we see here, this one was obstructing the foramen and after surgery kind of allowed for adequate decompression. More distally at the cerebral aqueduct, kind of we're more familiar with this in the pediatric population with congenital aqueductal stenosis, but this certainly can happen in adults. This is a 47-year-old that had a venous anomaly that was overlying, you can kind of see here where this arrow is, that was overlying the aqueduct, not allowing adequate drainage. And this is sort of a slow development of his hydrocephalus, but ultimately kind of required some sort of intervention. In his case, it was a shunt because they couldn't treat the venous anomaly adequately. And then kind of moving all the way to the fourth ventricle, again, going back to the pediatric population where these are usually can see either ependymomas, which this specific kind of case is, or medulloblastoma. Anything that is a space occupying lesion in the fourth ventricle can kind of have proximal hydrocephalus. So everything above that, so third ventricle, lateral ventricles are typically enlarged as well. And so there's many kind of intersections between the optic pathway and at least in the ventricular system. So going from the optic nerve into the chiasm kind of abuts or starts to get close to the third ventricle, definitely the optic tracts. As you move to the lateral geniculate nucleus, and then further in the optic radiations are typically less affected by hydrocephalus, but certainly can as well in fairly severe hydrocephalus. So there are sort of a kind of a bunch of proposed mechanisms of why hydrocephalus causes kind of the manifestations that we'll go over in a second. But the underlying issue is increased intracranial pressure. And so that can kind of have two outputs. So that's can have direct optic nerve sheath distension and choroidal folds, which can cause the defects we see in the visual on the visual fields, as well as axoplasmic stasis or the inability for axoplasmic transport due to the increased pressure, not having the kind of adequate fluid pressure or too much, As this progresses over time, you can kind of get optic disc swelling, axonal compression. If it lasts an even longer time, kind of hypoxiangliosis and eventually optic atrophy. But more acutely, you can kind of get nerve fiber layer edema or exudate, as well as subretinal fluid. If it's severe enough and acute enough, you can kind of get retinal hemorrhages as well. And so the mechanisms of injury are, as we sort of just described, mostly, at least the current thought is reduced axoplasmic transport due to increased pressure or possible venous congestion. But then there was sort of this fairly recent paper last year in Brain that drew samples of CSF from the lumbar subarachnoid space and the optic nerve subarachnoid space in patients with IIH as they were kind of moving towards optic nerve fenestration. And they noted this much higher concentration of lipocalin type prostaglandin D synthase, which they actually don't really come down on a definitive role for. They say possible, it is neuroprotective in some ways, but as it accumulates over time, it may have toxic effects. So this is really more of kind of an emerging theory, but certainly a possibility in terms of metabolite formation or stagnation. And so the common manifestations of these are papilledema. This diagram is from Moran actually. And so the grading at the Frizen scale, at least is the grades over one through five with subsequent, so as you get more and more obscuration of the optic disc and or the vessels overlying the optic disc, this sort of denotes worsening papilledema and more and more visual threatening edema, vision threatening edema. And sorry, going back to papilledema, so there's sort of a lot of these studies in monkeys, at least, where they intentionally cause these obstructions. And in a lot of the monkeys, their papilledema didn't occur until about 5 or 6 days. In some, it only took about 2 days of hydrocephalus to have this. But sort of papilledema is thought to be I guess what you would call subacute kind of finding in hydrocephalus, but certainly could be acute for some folks. Transient visual obscurations that are kind of more commonly seen in the non-obstructive or the idiopathic intracranial hypertension patients can be positional, worsen with postural change. And the exact mechanism of these TVOs isn't very well elucidated, but there's sort of two theories, both of which are relatively old. In the myelin distortion, kind of at these nodes of Ranvier in the 70s, were done on, they would sort of have traction on peripheral nerves and observe kind of the subsequent damage after, and thought that this may have a role in TVOs, as well as transient ischemia of the optic nerve. The retinal nerve fiber damage is kind of another manifestation. This is something that I've seen over and over again in neuro-ophtho clinic in folks with, again, typically the patients that I saw were IIH patients, but this could certainly happen in acute hydrocephalus, is swelling under kind of the between the retinal nerve fiber layer or under it. This typically manifests with is inferior arcuate visual field defects first and or widening of the blind spot. But in acute settings, in acute obstructive hydrocephalus, you can kind of get superimposed ischemic disc changes secondary to decreased orbital blood flow. And then there is sort of an honorable mention here for dorsal midbrain or paranoid syndrome. A lot of kind of what we see for paranoid is could be direct compression of the dorsal midbrain. But certainly if there's a more distal kind of compression that's causing enough hydrocephalus to put pressure on the tectum, the dorsal tectum, you could get this same syndrome. And so that's kind of characterized by an upward gaze palsy due to damage to the rostral interstitial nuclei of the medial longitudinal fasciculus, or MLF. You can get convergence retraction nystagmus, which is at least thought to be due to inhibition or decreased inhibition from kind of the supranuclear centers, as well as the bilateral eyelid retraction. So those are the relatively same proposed mechanism, as well as light near dissociation. And so that's also thought to be by compression of the posterior commissure, where the nuclei responsible are more dorsal for light than they are for near. And so you kind of get light near dissociation. And in cases with hydrocephalus, you can certainly get concomitant kind of papilledema as well. And this sort of the diagram here of the setting sun eyes or sun setting eyes in a lot of the pediatric patients with the macrocephaly here, again, denoting hydrocephaly. There's the kind of common other manifestations that are non-ophthalmologic would be headaches, nausea, vomiting, and altered mental status. And all of these are related to increased intracranial pressure. The treatment for these is, at least for obstructive hydrocephalus, is less sophisticated. It's typically, get rid of the obstruction in some way or relieve or divert the CSF that's causing the increased intracranial pressure. So for a bunch of the examples that I mentioned, for the colloid cyst, it's resection. For the venous anomaly, the thought was, attempts at taking care of this endovascularly, which was unsuccessful. And then for the fourth ventricular tumor, is again, it's resection. But in the folks where you need sort of more immediate treatment, we often can do external ventricular drains. to help divert CSF. For people that you can't get rid of the obstruction, you sort of can have long-term CSF diversion with implanted shunts. So that's ventriculo, either peritoneal, pleural in the lung cavity, or atrial shunts, as well as for children, it's a lot more common. We do endoscopic third ventriculostomies to divert CSF. And kind of one of the other ways to address this is with optic nerve sheath fenestration, again, aimed at sort of giving the CSF and the stagnant or the increased intracranial pressure sort of an outflow. And so that is all I have for my talk. These are my references, and then kind of happy to take any questions.